My man is true love. Wallah billah. I talked to him 2 times on the telephone. He is Turkish, lives 20 years in Holland. I am Turkish, I live in Turkey. I was born in Holland as a baby, already back to Turkey. I double passport. He said to me, I come to Turkey for getting acquainted. I said, okay, I come to airport, pick you up. I nervous, my heart, boom, 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 boom. I wait. My family asking and calling out to men, Munir Hayraj, you are Mr. Hayraj, no? Mr. Hayraj, are you Mr. Hayraj? No, I said, don't ask, it's not him. I know, I don't know him, but my heart knows. Finally, I see him. Mashallah. He tall, coat over arm. He looks, I look, Turkish airport spins. Boa, a bull, enters the arena. He comes with us family back to our house. Eh? Coffee, good food, talking, sleeping. Turkey, only one room with heater. Other rooms, cold. He whispers, I cannot sleep in the cold. I answer, me neither. Family to bed. We stay in that room with heater. A couch and chairs, 2 quilts. He couch, I chair. My head here. His head there, I sit, he lies, dark. I cannot sleep. Quiet talking and touching. Foot, carefully hand. I take hand. I ask, can I come beside you? He says, yes, come beside me. We under quilt and quiet. 2 minutes, quiet. Then he kisses me. First time I kiss somebody, first I don't understand, I wait. He kisses second time, he kisses third time, he kisses more. I answer, I understand now, kissing. We make sex 3 times that night. Pain in vagina, but I like. Me no orgasm yet. I don't understand sex immediately. He says, my vagina small is nice. Then we sleep. I small sleep. I am mountain. I fall from the mountain. I roll down from the mountain. And I am on top of the mountain. I roll down from myself. And I am below, and around the mountain is so beautiful. Quiet, empty, and bare warm air at the feet of the mountain. And behind it, fields of sand. And I roll down myself without effort. I fall just like that. And like that, I am on the mountain again. Then I'm awake. He wake. I say, I rolled down in myself. I fell over in myself. My heart knows I have started to blossom. He laughs. I ask, what is that? He says, tomorrow to library. Look up, orgasm. And laughs very loud. In the morning, he goes to the kitchen, he makes a coffee, later he makes a shower, I make a shower, he there too, together make a shower, it's nice. He stays in Turkey for 6 days, we had sex 6 nights. No more pain in vagina. And every time I roll down the mountain, I fall asleep in the sand. He, back to Holland, I try myself. I read auto orgasm book. I 2-3 times made it. It's not nice. When I try myself, it's pain. It's not rolling. When I hear voice on the telephone, sex already begins. My heart misses him. I ask, how do you sleep? He laughs. Why do you ask? I say, I don't sleep. Everything is open. Everything is wet. He says, you go by cucumber. Yeah, Turkish men talks like that. Eh? If a woman is left alone, she goes by cucumber. I say, you go to the shop of sex. I am a modern woman. You buy me, you send me plastic balloon men. I need men. He sent nothing. I called him. I say, I come to your Dutch airport. 1 week in Holland. Orgasm. Even better. When we look into each other's eyes, sex is good. He enters, standing downstairs by the door. He looks inside me. I look inside him. Even when no lamp is lit, we can see the eyes until house bursts. And we always sleep together. Eh? Even with the warm weather, we have always feet together. And sometimes I make a test. My foot is close to his foot. I pull foot away. His foot comes to my foot every time again. I must love. I love trembling house. On 7th day in Holland, he different man. He come home, I cook, he knock everything from the table, and then me. He said, benim evim, benim masam. Benim sandalyem, my house, my chair, my table. I go to toilet, I lock door, he red with anger. Kapı aç, benim kapım, open door, my door. Next day, he make fire. I sleep, I smell paraffin, I come out of bed, door open, everything smoke. I good woman. My culture not so good for me, I material. I shut myself in the stomach. To the hospital. Woman in bed next to me told me, he illegal in Holland for 20 years. I legal because of family, double passport. For that he marry me. My vagina, his green card.
Derin derin sevdalara watching a fragment of the Veiled Monologues, and the entire performance can be enjoyed in the course of this week, and the artists were Meral Polat and Sevai Okyai.
So, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Netherlands, to The Hague. Welcome to the third World Conference of Women's Shelters.
My name is Jacobine Geel.
And I am Aldith Hunkar.
And we will be moderating during the course of this week all the events you will be participating in the plenary sessions.
That's right. We'll be guiding you through the program, so to speak.
And we are very excited.
First time we're working together, Jacobine?
Yes, and not excited because you're all watching us, although indeed it is a first time. But I think excited mostly because all eyes and all cameras this week are directed towards the issue we are dealing with here today, tomorrow, and the days after: violence against women and what we can do to help it, and if better even, to prevent it.
Yes. So maybe we should start with a very practical subject.
Yes, let's do that.
This whole conference will be in English, but for those of you speaking French or Spanish, you will find earphones with translations on it. So please check out the scheme here behind me to know which channel to tune into.
And one other practical issue: the entire World Forum is, of course, dealing with free Wi-Fi, only not this conference room. We have held it free from Wi-Fi in order to get the utmost of your attention.
Exactly, but we do expect you to send out your tweets as soon as you leave this room.
And we have a hashtag.
Yes, we do.
Hashtag 3WCWS.
That's right, 3WCWS.
So please make us trending all week.
Take pictures. Say nice things about Jacobine.
No, Aldith.
Yes.
It's time, I think, to introduce the chairs of this conference. Femke Halsema and Bandana Reining will be greeting you on their own. Please welcome. Join us. Thank you. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
Please. Hi.
Hi, good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Your center.
Wow, it's exciting to be here.
Yes, it is.
I am Bandana Rana. I'm the chair of the Global Network of Women Shelters. I am from a very small country, very far away from here, Nepal, which is in Asia. I belong to an organization called Sathi, which means friend in Nepali. And we have been pioneers working on violence against women, particularly domestic violence, and operating shelters for women and children for the last 20 years. We believe in saving lives, creating opportunities, and promoting peace and nonviolence.
Good afternoon again. I am Femke Halsema. I'm the chair of the Dutch Organization for Women Shelters, the organization that created this conference for the coming 4 days. Well, to be honest, I'm not the one who has worked really hard. I'm going to introduce them to you later on. I fought for women's rights, I think, all through my career as a political leader for the Dutch Green Party, as a parliamentarian, and now as an independent writer and filmmaker. Let me welcome you on behalf of our organizations, dear guests, care workers, survivors, women from all over the world who have come to The Hague. It is with great pleasure and it is a great honor to welcome you here this afternoon. Thank you.
Jacobine, I'm giving it over to you. I'll see you in a moment.
Honorable ministers, excellencies, distinguished guests, delegates from all around the world, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed very, very exciting to be here and very historical. particularly for those of us who have been working directly with survivors of violence, facing the challenges in running shelters, and knowing that adequate attention or focus has not been given to shelters. On behalf of the Global Network of Women Shelters, I welcome you to the opening ceremony of the Third World Conference of Women Shelters. We know that violence against women, whether it is trafficking, sexual violence, violence faced by migrant women or refugees, sexual abuse, you know, they are all the worst forms of violation of human rights. However, there are plenty of work on reduction, awareness raising to reduce violence against women. But for years, the attention on shelters has not been adequate. Just reducing violence, protection or prevention or raising awareness is not enough. When women and girls face violence, they need a secure place, a safe house, they need legal mechanism, they need justice, they need the opportunity to rebuild their lives. So without supporting shelters, the issue of violence against women cannot be addressed adequately. And it was with this objective that the Global Network of Women Shelters was formed. In 2008, the first World Conference was held in Canada by our Canadian sisters, and that is when we formed this global network. The second World Conference was in 2012 in Washington, D.C., and today we are gathered here to mark the Third World Conference of Women Shelters. We are very hopeful that the attention and the support required by shelters all around the world will be provided through this conference. We are hopeful also because recently the UN has passed a very important and valuable document, which is Transforming Our World, the 2030 Development Agenda, with a goal 5 for ending violence against women and gender equality. We really hope that this conference will also contribute to that goal, not only by doing work in shelters and addressing violence against women, but also by holding our governments, UN agencies, our development partners, and also business and corporate sectors accountable. That is what the Global Network of Women Shelters is also committed to do. I'm very happy to share that the Global Network of Women Shelters works to share experiences from all around the world, strengthen our own experiences, build capacity, but to make the shelter work visible through data count, which is coordinated by our Canadian members and sisters. We are also working on strengthening the global network. We are proud to say that there are regional and continental networks, the oldest one being the European network, WAVE, which just celebrated its 20 years of existence. We also have inter-American networks. We have the Asian Network of Women Shelters, who is emerging to be very strong. We are hoping that there is an African network as well, but we are hoping that there will be a MENA and Oceania network very soon. So with networks in all the continents of the world, the Global Network of Women Shelters is going to be a very powerful, recognized voice to address the voices of shelters and the work of shelters. I would also like to share that as chair of the Global Network of Women Shelters, you will be seeing me quite often. I will try to, with the help of the moderators, the professional moderators here, I will try to connect the different events that we have over here. May I share with you that we will also on Thursday be presenting the data count again, like I said earlier, which is going to be, it's making the work of the shelters visible. That's what we are going to do. On the last day of the conference, there will be a call for action, a declaration, which we have drafted with the help of all our members. We expect all the participants who have come from all around the world, from different continents, to contribute to this call for action through our board members who are here, or also through the caucus meetings that you have, so that we integrate your concerns in this call for action, which will be our way forward in promoting peace, promoting nonviolence, and promoting the work of shelters. Thank you so much.
The coming days, we will exchange experiences and knowledge. To meet each other, we are here. But this conference is not only set up to network. We are here together to increase cooperation and to raise awareness and develop approaches to end violence against women. And we want to connect in the coming days with the other parties in society who are here also. The stakeholders in governments, in the corporate sector, and in the academia. Most importantly, for the coming days, as we all know, many care workers in women's shelters do their work in isolation and sometimes in threatening circumstances, with great risks for their lives. We are going to listen to their stories, as we are going to listen to the stories of the survivors. And we are going to applaud their courage. There are 5 overall themes in the plenary sessions and workshops. You will find them in your program, and our hosts are going to explain them to you. They will enable us to discuss, for instance, the importance of economic independence, the horror of sexual violence in conflict, and the rise of virtual violence. We also hope to learn from each other about the importance of new laws and guidelines, about enhancing the financial sustainability of women's shelters. As you can see, there are 150 different sessions, and we hope they will inspire you. I think everyone here assembled feels great responsibility to stop the worldwide violence against women and children. We hope that these 4 days will not only inspire you and bring you new friends and colleagues, but also give you strength and power to continue our mutual fight against the suppression of women. Before the program starts, let me just thank everybody who has made the conference possible. I thank our partners and sponsors from the corporate and public sector who made the conference possible. They are too many to mention separately, and I apologize in advance. Especially, I want to thank the Dutch government, who is here. 5 different ministries made the conference possible, are involved, and the municipality of The Hague. And last but not least, I already said something about it, I want to thank the project team who worked for 1.5 years to make this conference possible. Thank you.
Our chairs, who will be joining us again on stage later on. The network Bandana Rana was speaking about will be made tangible to you within very short time, I promise. But before that, I'm very proud to introduce to you the representative of our government, our Minister of Education, Culture and Science, and of Emancipation, which makes her very connected to this topic, Mevrouw Jet Bussemaker.
Ladies and gentlemen, at the start of this year, a touching video went viral on social media. Maybe you have seen it. In it, 5 young Italian boys, all around the age of 9, are each introduced to a girl who's just a bit older than they are. An off-screen interviewer asks the boys, "What do you like about her?" "Her eyes," they respond. "Her hair." They are allowed to touch her. They stroke her arm, her cheek, and her hair. The boys are careful in their movements, even a tad shy. Then the voice suddenly instructs them to slap her. Their faces immediately change to sadness and shock. You see doubt, disbelief, shame. The voice is insistent. Slap her, hard. But they all refuse. Not a single boy will hit her. Without exception, they all say, no. Why not? The voice asks. The boys offer a number of reasons. Because I don't want to hurt her. Because I'm against violence. Even because I'm a man. And one boy comments, it's like that saying, you are not allowed to hit girls, not even with a flower. Ladies and gentlemen, this video is a powerful illustration of what we all know. Violence against women and girls is wrong, always. And yet, it remains a common occurrence. Worldwide, 1 in 3 women will be subjected to violence or sexual abuse in the course of her lifetime. It can happen while on the street, at home, the very place one should feel safe, and during times of war. We know that sexual violence is prevalent in armed conflicts. Therefore, we can be certain that among the swells of refugees entering Europe, there will be many women who've been victimized. Stopping the violence begins with breaking the silence, overcoming taboos, and with recognizing cause and effect relationships. It's important that we speak openly about what these women need so that they may safely participate in society. With the help of social organizations and aid workers, governments play a pivotal role in helping these women. Authorities have to work to prevent and tackle violence against women in a responsible and constructive manner. That's why here in the Netherlands, several ministries are collaborating closely with municipalities, the police, the justice system, and NGOs to confront domestic assault head on. It is precisely because violence knows no boundaries nor distinguishes between culture that it needs to be addressed by the international community. No country has the right to turn away from the issue on the basis of cultural, economic, or religious grounds. It is simply unacceptable that victims of violence dare not talk about what they experienced for fear of being stigmatized, or that women feel unable to make use of their rights, resulting in the perpetrators going unpunished. And now that so many people, including many women and children, have been displaced, that question is more relevant than ever. I'm both happy and proud, ladies and gentlemen, that the Netherlands has been given the honor of hosting this year's World Conference on Women's Shelters, and that the Global Network will base its headquarters in The Hague. Over the coming days, I believe our discussion must extend beyond the violence itself. Rather, we should be part of the solution and discuss ways to prevent violence. Examples could include promoting healthy, equal relationships, whether political, social, economic, or sexual, between men and women, helping children and young people to process their experiences, and working to prevent violence from reoccurring in families in the future. As the Minister of Emancipation and Education, I believe two more factors are crucial in preventing violence: an education and a paid job for women. Why? because empowerment and independence go hand in hand. Of course, someone can be emotionally trapped in a relationship, but education makes you mentally stronger. Your horizons expand, and this makes you less likely to accept the situation as is. And if you can earn enough to support yourself and your family, you're both financially stronger and more independent. This is also the idea behind my cross-country tour of the past 2 years. I've been speaking with more than 12,000 women in the Netherlands about being financially independent and using their talents. And I am also excited about the Dutch project, The Nieuwe Toekomst, which translates to the new future. And tomorrow, Maxima, our queen, will be attending a workshop for this project, whose objective it is to help women to find a job, volunteer work, or training. And the results so far have been quite positive. But despite the progress, the large group of refugees coming to the Netherlands represents a challenge for us. Many of them come from dysfunctional societies in which frustration, stress, and widespread poverty often lead to domestic and sexual violence against women. How do we first obtain and then keep a close eye on women and girls in a group who have been victimized? How should we approach families for whom it is not customary for women to receive an education or work outside the home? How can we ensure in places where refugees are awaiting a better future, regional shelter facilities and asylum centers, places where frustration can mount, that we prevent violence against women? And if it does occur, how do we ensure that these crimes are punished? How can we approach women in a way that suits their backgrounds and experiences? And how can we provide role models for these same women? It's my hope that even though we may have no ready-made solutions, these questions will be discussed in the coming days. Ladies and gentlemen, the Italian boys from the video have learned that violence against women and girls is wrong. Hopefully, they will remember this lesson for the rest of their lives and teach their sons and daughters the importance of healthy, equal relationships. Let us also teach our own sons and daughters this very same thing. This conference provides a wonderful platform for the exchange of perspectives and experiences. I trust that we will have an excellent closing statement with many common conclusions. And I hope that you will have a very inspiring conference. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister Bussemaker. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen.
One or two.
It's quite possible that you're feeling very connected, do you?
I'm not sure.
Can I hear you? Okay, but we thought it might be time for a little action.
Yes.
Or even interaction. And we take you through this process step by step. First, the board members of the Global Network on Women Sheltering will introduce themselves to you, and they represent all the continents present here today. Aldit, take it away.
Well, I'm going to ask some work from you, so I'm going to start right here, and I'd like you to introduce yourself and welcome the people in your language, etc. Please face the audience.
Okay. 我从亚洲来，从台湾来，但是我在这边欢迎所有来自亚洲的参与成员。希望站起来，亚洲的，来自亚洲的。Yeah, English?
No.
Yes.
Can you ask him to stand
okay.
up now?
So please, from the Asian people, please right now stand up, okay?
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much. Please stand. Please stay. Your turn now. Can you come? Yeah, and face the audience.
Hello. My name is Mary Barikungere. I come from Rwanda, but I present here today the Africa Network of Women Shelters. While I welcome my brothers and sisters from Africa, please stand up and we give you a warm welcome. Murakaza neza.
Thank you.
Karibuni Africa, Karibuni Africa. Welcome, welcome, welcome.
No, nobody sit back down. Can you just remain standing, please? The people who just
Africa,
stood up,
Karibuni,
standing.
Maybe that's a warm welcome, a unifying Swahili message to say, welcome to the GNWS platform.
Thank you, thank
this
you.
This is home for you.
All right. Thank you. So let me explain the rules. I'd like the people who have stood up already to remain standing. This is not a sitting situation. So please remain
action.
Standing. It's your, it's your turn. We want everybody to stand up in the end. That's the thing. So please welcome your
Asia,
people.
Asia, please stand up.
Asia, please stand up again. Yes, thank you. Yes, your turn.
اهلا وسهلا اسمي فاطمه الطالب من مركز ايواء بالمغرب اهلا وسهلا مجددا بالمشاركين والمشاركات من الشرق الاوسط وشمال افريقيا المرجو النهوض شكرا can you
شكرا thank you so this is becoming very interesting. Your turn now.
Hola.
Español, sí, por favor.
Hola, soy Margarita Guillé de México. Actualmente coordino la red interamericana de refugios, casas de acogida, albergues y centros para mujeres que agrupa aproximadamente 17 países del continente. Y quiero pedirles a quienes estén aquí desde Alaska a la Patagonia, Chile y Argentina, pasando por el Caribe, que nos pongamos de pie, y quienes son integrantes de RIRE, que lo hagamos.
América Latina en pie, por favor. Gracias, gracias. Yes. No, you stand. Keep standing. I know you're tired, but keep standing.
Hello, I'm Margaret Ogarenos from Australia. I'd like to welcome all of the delegates from Australia, New Zealand, all of our Pacific Island and Oceania neighbours to stand up, please.
Thank you.
And I'm Julie Obrin, I'm chair of WESNET. Part of the Global Network of Women's Shelters. And I'd, in tradition, Australian culture and tradition, like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the country, of the land that we're meeting on today, and pay my respects to any elders past and present.
So, thank you. Nobody standing. Let me just cross over to the other side, ladies and gentlemen. There's more people of the World Network sitting on this side, starting with you, yes.
Hello, everyone. I'm Kaofeng Lee. I'm with the U.S. National Network to End Domestic Violence. So welcome to all of you, and welcome to the delegates from the United States.
Shalom. אני רותי עוזרי מישראל. מברכת את כל מי שנמצא פה. יש פה רק עוד שתי אורחות ממדינת ישראל. אני מבקשת שתקומו.
Yes, thank you. Can you pass on the mic?
ברוכים הבאים.
Your turn.
Hello, I'm from Armenia. Please stand up, Armenian, if there are here. I know there are.
Don't hide.
Ողջույն բոլոր հայերին. Ուրախ եմ, որ դուք եք այստեղ. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Sheila Swasson. I'm Mi'kmaq from Listigouche, Quebec, and president of the National Aboriginal Circle Against Family Violence. I want to welcome all the Indigenous women from around the world to the World Conference.
And please stand up. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Jan Reimer from Canada, also with the Alberta Council of Women Shelters that hosted the first World Conference of Women Shelters. So really excited and pleased to be here today. And we were able to welcome women from around the world to the traditional lands of the Cree and Treaty 6 in Edmonton in 2008. So everyone from Canada, please stand.
Oh, that's a lot of you. That's a lot of Canadians. Thank you.
Bonsoir. Bonsoir. Mon nom est Manon Monestis. Je représente la Fédération des maisons d'hébergement pour femmes de la province du Québec au Canada. Et je salue et je souhaite la bienvenue à tous les délégués francophones du Canada et de la francophonie.
Et mettez-vous debout. Merci. Did I have everybody here? One more? Yes.
Hi, everyone. I'm Vanang from Vietnam. In Vietnam, now have new network, it's ZBV network, just organized two months ago. I'm very happy to be here. I would like to invite us, every people from Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos who come from...
Thank you.
Thank
you. So did we have all of, did we cover, no, one more. Thank you, sorry.
Hello, my name is Rosa Loga. I'm the president of the feminist network WAVE, Women Against Violence Europe. And I want to welcome here all of you and especially also my sisters from Europe.
Thank you so much. Thank you. Jacobine. Wow, look
yes,
at that,
it's
Jacobine.
Great. It's working.
Is everybody standing now? Yes,
yes,
everybody's
so.
Standing
okay.
Now. Welcome, welcome.
Keep standing. Keep standing. Now comes the hard part. You have to bow and search under your chair.
There's
a bit on the left side
of
your chair.
It's an Oprah moment, yes.
And there's a little surprise for you. It's really tiny, so search carefully. Yes, you're the first. That's your prize.
Good. Everybody found it. So what we want you to do, ladies and gentlemen, once you find your little surprise, isn't this a wonderful Oprah moment? Are you finding it? It's on a ridge, on the left side, underneath. Yeah. Are you finding it here? Check the ridge, like that, on the left side. Yeah, good. I love chaos.
Did you find it?
On the left side.
Okay.
Look at there, it fell already, yeah. So isn't that a wonderful little pin that they're finding?
What we call this is holy chaos. And I want you to pay a little more attention.
Your attention, please, ladies and
gentlemen. Because
we want you to make friends.
What we ask from you now is not to put this little pin on your own chest, but to put it on the chest of someone who is sitting behind you or before you. And the first two rows are going to show it to you.
There you go, make new friends. Pin it onto your new friends. Are you finding it here? Are you okay? It's on the little ledge, look here.
Yeah,
okay. You pin it on somebody behind you or in front of you. Yeah, man, it should be here.
No pin?
No. I'm from a country and I think we are the only ones here.
There you go. It's so tiny. Pin it on somebody else, behind you or in front of you. Be friends. Make friends. There. This is what we like to see. Good going. Wat een heerlijke chaos. Yeah. Are you doing okay? Did you make friends already?
We did.
Wonderful,
yeah.
Wonderful. You're showing the world how it works. Wonderful,
yes,
wonderful.
Maggie.
You look great.
I'm from the United States and I'm Joy from South Africa.
Welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
Yeah. Did you find yours?
Finally.
Good, very good. Is everyone adorned now? You know what, Jacobine, I think they'll be doing this all night.
Yes, it's great.
They're having a great time, making friends.
It's very good, very good. Okay, we did it ourselves, agree. Can we sit down again, please?
And
thank
try
you.
To restore some kind of order here.
There is one thing I have to say, because we don't want anyone to feel left out. And so we also welcome the two people from Aruba present here.
Ah, yes, you are very well done, yes. So let me see, shall I call?
Yes, please, because this pin, what is it about?
The pin.
What is it?
Ladies and gentlemen, I know you're really excited about the pin, but maybe you're wondering what the pin is all about. So for that, I would like to call on stage Caterina Occhio. Caterina, dove sei?
Where is she?
There you are, Caterina. Please stand here.
The pin lady.
This is the pin lady. Caterina Occhio, ladies and gentlemen, of CIMI. What is the pin all about?
Well, the pin is part of a dream.
Yeah?
And that started many years ago with Rikir, Lisbeth, Sepide, and many more women in Turkey. And the dream was to give a sustainable future and a possibility of a second chance to survivors of violence. All the pin you received, all of them, each and every one, has been done in Tunisia by women that come from the shelter home of the Amal Association. They are hired by our company that is called CIMI, and our motto is no charity, just work.
Ah.
That's what
that's
we
good.
Believe in. And I'm very proud to say that together with my beautiful friends, this dream now is a reality where our hearts are sold in over 90 shops around the world, where we are the only fair trade certified company in the Middle East. Wow. And we continue being in the Middle East. We don't go away from the Middle East. It's very important that we stay there. And we hope to hire 100 women in 5 years. That's
very good.
Great. Wow. And we hope we give you a good prize for all these pins.
You do?
Yes?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much. Caterina Occhio.
Okay, thank you.
Caterina. All right.
Okay, after all this excitement and action and interaction and making new friends, it's time to calm down a little bit and concentrate on the topic we're here for. And let's do that by listening to our keynote speaker, Mrs. Hina Jilani from Pakistan, who is a renowned human rights activist and an affiliate to the UN Center Conference on Women and Violence. Please, Ms. Jilani.
Honorable Minister, ladies and gentlemen, I feel extremely privileged to be amongst this group of people who have not only committed their lives to working for survivors of violence, but are also making progress in explaining to the world that however hard it may be, it is worthwhile to play this important role for the advancement of the rights of women in particularly difficult circumstances. So I thank the organizers for inviting me to be here and to speak to you, share my experiences, and learn from the valuable experiences that people around this room have gathered in their work, both as those who have cared and those who have survived. Ladies and gentlemen, my belief is that the fundamental principle on which shelter policies are founded is protection and support for women offered without compromising their fundamental right to liberty and human dignity. Shelters give a broad meaning to security and design their policies and programs with the objective of assisting women in enhancing their capacity to gain economic independence as well as personal autonomy. The purpose of providing shelter is to give women a space where they can plan their future in an environment free of tensions and with the support they desperately need to build a productive life for themselves and for their families. Counseling, legal aid, crisis management, skill development, and social integration are some of the strategies employed to achieve these objectives. However, let us not forget that any program for women's empowerment must have as its long-term objective the provision of political support to women's human rights and to give women a confidence in the social and cultural legitimacy of these rights, as well as in the efforts for their attainment. Shelters are part of the strategies to combat violence against women and aim to strengthen the concept of protection for women that recognizes and respects their right to liberty and dignity. This strategy includes the institutionalization of interventions that we make in order to put in place a protection system for women with the involvement of actors from the state and the civil society. Women in many parts of the world are the most vulnerable to violation of their rights to life, liberty, and security of person, where social attitudes, cultural practices, and religious precepts have allowed violence against women. Laws have failed to provide either adequate safeguards against violence or to promote attitudes conducive to the enjoyment of their fundamental rights by women. Generally, state institutions lack both sensitivity and capacity to deal with gender-specific violence. In more recent years, some progressive legislation has resulted from the advocacy of women's rights organizations the world over. However, mechanisms for their effective enforcement and implementation are still either non-existent or dysfunctional. Experiences of women show that both state and non-state entities are responsible for the growing incidence of violence against them. Women's sexuality is particularly controlled, and any assertion of autonomy on her part in this respect receives a strong and violent reaction. Killing women in the name of family or tribal honor is widely practiced in different social settings the world over. The incidence of domestic violence is so common that in many parts of the world, it is almost a universal experience for the female population of all ages and different socioeconomic backgrounds. Women's right to liberty is restricted in the name of modesty, protection, or prevention of immoral activity. Sui juris, adult women, are placed in involuntary confinement under many circumstances, including by institutions that are mandated to provide protection against violence. All this is done in the name of social morality. Even courts have, in many instances, refused to intervene to protect women from illegal confinement on the ground that her right to liberty is subject to conformity to social norms, and any suspicion that she may not abide by the prevalent standards of morality can disentitle her from receiving relief, even if she has been admitted in a shelter which is supposed to give her support and redress. Where states have taken initiatives as an attempt at confronting the issue of violence, these attempts can only succeed if institutions respond in a manner that recognizes the responsibility of the state as a right of women and not as a concession afforded by governments. It is also becoming apparent that legal aid alone cannot solve the problems faced by women. The social stigma attached to litigation or imprisonment, for instance, in countries like mine, restrictions on free choice in marriage, no legal protection or financial security for divorced women, leave women who are passing through this experience shelterless and exposed to further exploitation and oppression. Social attitudes and state neglect are the major causes of the disempowerment of women. Resistance to the concept of gender equality and justice remains the main obstacle in the way of change. While many national constitutions recognize equality and guarantee non-discrimination, these have become mere paper victories for women in a society that refuses to give them the status and autonomy necessary for the actual realization of these rights. Social actors responsible for violence against women enjoy almost complete impunity from accountability. The family is still considered so benign that even international human rights instruments say it is the basic unit of society. If it has to be the basic unit of society, the families have to become benign and recognize the right of women and children, their right to freedom from fear and from violence. Policy of states is largely influenced by interest groups that are dominated by religious and conservative elements who use religion, culture, or tradition in many settings in the world to deny women the benefits of any constitutional or legal protections that exist. Political and economic instability in many countries has added to women's problems. Lack of strong institutions and mechanisms has left them without adequate, effective, and gender-sensitive measures for redress, especially in situations where there are political or social conflicts. Women's economic problems multiply when they are denied opportunities of development and are left to compete for jobs in a diminishing market with no skills and a lack of qualifications. Social attitudes that condemn women who seek personal autonomy or financial independence has further compounded the problems of women who are deprived of support by the family and are driven out of the home because of violence or other forms of oppression. They face social ostracism, discrimination in employment and exploitation, sexual, social, and economic. While the state is primarily responsible for guaranteeing rights, a strong civil society is essential to ensure that these rights can be exercised. The civil society does have a strong section that is committed to the advancement of women. However, its influence on the state depends on the existence of independent and strong democratic institutions, as well as on persistent advocacy that is required for the degree of impact necessary for change. The state has deliberately created sensitivities around some areas of social rights of women. It has been more difficult to remove barriers in these areas, especially where these areas conflict with the so-called notions of culture, tradition, and religion. Despite the adverse conditions, however, trends are emerging globally that indicate some level of success in changing social attitudes. Women's rights advocacy is beginning to influence state policy. Activities such as shelters for women are gradually gaining more attention and state support. However, let me remind you that however much of a commitment we have in improving women's lives and to giving them a space within shelters where they can sit without tensions and think of the way forward and how to make their future, the fact remains that these women are not meant to live all their lives in shelters. They have to go out there in the real world. And it is therefore absolutely critical that we make sure that shelters are not only providing protection to women while they are inside shelters, but are also influencing change, where mindsets are developed so that women's resettlement becomes possible, and their resettlement in the same communities where they experienced violence becomes possible. It is therefore absolutely crucial that make sure that our advocacy focuses on creating effective mechanisms, systems, and processes for the implementation of laws and policies related to protection of women's rights. Our job is not restricted to managing and running shelters. We must become advocates for the survivors who, in actual terms, must be seen to have survived, not just the emotional trauma, but have the necessary elements in the outside world to be able to rebuild their lives and to live in a better environment than when they had to enter the shelter. Laws and policies that can be agents of change in the mindsets. Those mindsets that reject women's autonomy and seek to maintain a control on their lives, a control that is really detrimental to their best interest. We must influence communities and make it easier for women to resettle themselves and to make a life for themselves with dignity. 25 years ago, I started a shelter in Pakistan called Dastak. The name means knock. It symbolizes the openness of society. A woman just has to knock and come in, and she will receive support, and she will receive help. I'm a lawyer. I had no idea how to run a shelter. The reason why I started this was because I understood that just giving legal services to women is not enough anymore. There are other needs that are as critical as her winning a legal battle. My clients used to come outside my house saying they've been turned out by their maternal family or paternal family under different kinds of circumstances, and she's left without a shelter. And this is why I thought it is important that these women must have a shelter. But looking around me, I saw that all the shelters that existed at that time in my city and in my country used custodial restraint on women. These victims of violence were treated as prisoners, and this was unacceptable to me. In these 25 years, I have learned a lot for the almost 7,500 women that my shelter has served. Everything that I know today about the meaning of rights, the meaning of dignity, I have learned from these women. And I appreciate and give them tribute for not only surviving, but also teaching others what survival means in actual and real life. Our job is not to create dependency. Our job is to recognize that women are not unintelligent. They can make up their own minds, can make good decisions for their lives. They only need the support of friends, and not just practitioners, who will see their problems, who will recognize that there is a need to address those problems and do whatever they can in the narrow legal frameworks or the difficult social climates that they work in. Ladies and gentlemen, I will conclude by one plea. Dastak has launched a campaign entitled Protection with Dignity and is actively engaging legislators, policymakers, and practitioners in the field of protection in order to change the mindset of the duty bearers towards the concept of women's protection, a protection that does not create further isolation, but actually empowers and liberates a woman. My plea to you today is, please, adopt this slogan of protection with dignity globally so that we understand that women's protection really must have the right kind of results and make it even more stronger as a prospect for them to attain and realize their human rights. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Mrs. Jilani, for your clear explanation of how broad the strategy should be in order to really address this difficult issue of violence against women. And it includes politics, religion, culture. It's a very broad spectrum, and we have to include it all in our strategy. Thank you very much. We now come to a very special moment in this event. Until now, we have been connecting with each other. Now, we will start connecting with the world outside. And we will do this through a very special edition of Women World News.
Third World Conference of Women Shelters held in The Hague. New UN facts and figures on violence against women. And She Fighter, strengthening and empowering women in Jordan. Good evening for WWN. I am Aldith Hunkar. The Third World Conference of Women Shelters has started in The Hague, in Netherlands. In 4 days' time, participants from over 100 countries will focus on how to connect and act in their joint mission to end violence against women. European royalty, international dignitaries, and experts from the work field will all work together in a framework of 5 themes that will be highlighted later on in this news program. During the first World Conference of Women Shelters in Edmonton, Canada, in 2008, the plan was launched to organize a global conference every 4 years. In 2012, the second conference was organized in Washington, D.C., and attended by more than 1,000 delegates from over 80 countries. The results of those conferences were the connection between global participants who shared their best practices and knowledge. They realized how similar their experiences are and were inspired to see how many people are committed to doing this work. The strengthening of regional, national, and continental networks, and the start of a global network. A global data count, one day count of how many women and children ask for help from women's shelters around the world. And renewed hope and energy to continue working for positive change. And today marks the start of the Third World Conference of Women's Shelters, building on the foundations laid down by its predecessors. The main objective is to connect and act, a call upon all parties, whether they be private, corporate, national, or international, to take responsibility for the elimination of violence against women and children. And the five themes this week are economic independence of women survivors, sustainable financing and advocacy, transboundary violence against women, international exchange and cooperation, continents, what's happening, strengthening regional networks, and innovative approaches to eliminating violence against women and supporting survivors. The UN recently released a report about violence against women containing collected data from 89 countries. The good news is that the number of countries collecting data has risen from 44 over the past decade. The report contains shocking data as shown in this world map. Women across the world, regardless of income, age, or education, are subject to physical, sexual, psychological, and economical violence. Intimate partner violence accounts for the majority of women's experience of violence. Prevalence of sexual violence is lower than that of physical violence. However, in intimate relationships, they are often experienced together. One in three women has experienced physical or sexual violence at some point in their lives. Two in three victims of intimate partner and family-related homicide are women. Less than 40% of women who experience violence seek help of any sort, and of those, less than 10% seek help from the police. This is the case in almost all countries with data, so it's a good thing that the Dutch National Police is an active partner in this conference. Now, these findings are not new. They are the reason for this conference. They show beyond any doubt the need of joint efforts and joint responsibility to end violence against women. Yo soy esa mujer. I am that woman. I am the woman that you are talking about. In the southern part of Mexico, a woman from a rural indigenous community was in a violent relationship for years, but had the courage to leave her village and seek help at a women's shelter in the town of San Cristobal de las Casas. She felt empowered by the program, and alimony was arranged, which gave her the possibility to start a new life.
Mi corazón es que es muy grande. Porque antes sentía que yo no valía para nada. Rechacé mi cuerpo, yo rechacé todo lo que yo sentía porque había tanta humillación o porque había tantos problemas. Pero ya ahorita ya no. ¿Por qué vienes a quejar? Si tu marido lo conozco bien, es mi amigo. ¿Tú qué piensas? Si eres mujer, regresa en tu casa, vete a lavar. O no tienes trabajo en tu casa, es lo que dicen las autoridades.
Hay usos y costumbres que le hacen mucho daño a las mujeres indígenas. Cuando una mujer llega directamente al juzgado de paz y conciliación, a mí no me avisan. Prefieren resolverlo entre hombres. El hombre de acá sí le tiene más respeto a las autoridades tradicionales que a cualquier otra autoridad.
He visto casos en donde pues las mujeres salen totalmente golpeadas o a veces demandadas. La mujer llega a pedir pensión alimenticia, pero el marido mañoso la contrademanda diciendo que esos hijos no son de él y que ella es una mala mujer que se mete con todo mundo, y entonces la mujer sale demandada.
Ellos dicen, pues es mi mujer, yo tengo derecho sobre ella, si yo la compré.
Un día cuando mi esposo llegó tomado, me golpeó, me corrió. Era noche ya como las 7:30. Me fui corriendo con mis hijos, sin dirección dónde voy. Me fue a sentar en una esquina. Dios mío, ¿qué voy a hacer? Con llanto salí allí. Y me fui. Fui en un lugar, en una casa de su familia. Y yo le dije, préstame una noche tu casa porque aquí voy a quedar. Yo misma sentía yo muy mal.
Cuando llegué en Cavite, me llevaron en un refugio. Y allí me quedé 3 meses y medio con mis hijos. Te dan más valor. Te dan fuerzas lo que no tienes o lo que no puedes pensar. Escuchan lo que sentimos o entienden lo que sentimos. Y allí me apoyaron con un abogado. Y ahorita tengo la casa, tengo la pensión. Aunque la gente no me valora, pero yo mismo me valoro. Yo porque yo sé que valgo mucho.
This is a story about women starting a help center for victims of domestic violence in Vilnius, Lithuania, supported by women from the Nordic countries and volunteers. The help center works with the police to heighten attention to domestic violence based on the new violence law that results from a lobby by women's organizations.
Good evening. So thank you for the introduction. So to elaborate more about what was said, so we have new approach. When the police receive a report from women experiencing domestic violence, they not only start the investigation, but they send the report to our specialized help center. After receiving this report, we proactively contact the victim, and mostly the services that we provide are proactive consultations, women empowerment, and reinforcement of women's rights. As a women organization, we are confident and competent to assess the safety of the woman, her way of processing it, and to establish the connection of and relationship of trust. When the contact is established and she's ready to take steps, we explain her rights, what institutions could and should do on her request, how to be safe from violence. We offer her specialized psychological and legal aid and help her to write her statements, mediate on her behalf in the institutions and support the woman through the whole process towards her independence and safety from violence. So it's not only about giving her a bed, it's about educating the woman and seeking redress of her rights. We stay strong for more than 20 years, and in sisterhood we trust. Thank you.
Women's shelters should be extra alert for signs of strangulation in women, says Pat Vargas of A Safe Place in Canada. In a study of 300 strangulation victims, the statistics show how difficult it is to recognize the signs of strangulation. Yet strangulation often results in serious health issues. 85% of the respondents reported persistent difficulty with breathing. Nearly 45 reported voice changes or difficulty with swallowing. 83% reported anxiety and also reported loss of sensation, left or right-sided weakness, neck pain, and miscarriage. And Ms. Pat Vargas will give a workshop on the subject on Friday. Lili Tapa from Nepal advocates improvement of the position of widows in her country. Traditionally, widows belong to their deceased husband's family. They are often victims of sexual violence and slavery. Through various actions, Lily has been increasingly successful in supporting these widows.
The situation of widows in Nepal is miserable. Widowhood makes them physically alive but socially dead. Widows are the most neglected and rapidly increasing category of women. The rituals of breaking bangles, having to eat clean food, restricted from participating in any auspicious function, restricted mobility, deprivation from getting share of husband's property, and abject poverty make their life pitiable and desperate. Early marriage practices and the recent conflict have further intensified the plight, especially those of young widows, making them vulnerable to exploitation and trafficking. Women for Human Rights, Single Women Group, WHR, a non-profit organization, was established in 1994 with the vision to create non-discriminatory and equitable society so that single women are empowered economically, politically, and socio-culturally to live dignified lives enjoying values of human rights.
And now with us in the studio talking to Jacobine Geel is Lili Tapa.
Lili Tapa, when did you personally decide to stand up and speak about this issue of violence against widows in Nepal?
Actually, when I became a widow at a very young age, when I was just 29, when my husband died in a peace mission in Iraq in Gulf War. So I, being an independent and educated widows, I have to go through a lot of a trauma in my family and outside in the workplace. Mm-hmm. So I decided to advocate.
It is almost, for me, when I see this, as if you are punished when you become a widow.
Yes, I am from the country where, you know, the women are, in the past, women were burnt alive in the funeral pyre of the deceased husbands. But that practice is no more now. But what we have experienced that the widows are physically alive, but they are socially dead. Yeah. Due to the many ill cultural practices that every woman in my country have to go through after their husband's death, which is too inhuman.
And what is the focus of your actions now?
Actually, we do advocate for the rights of the widows. We have many ill cultural practices that we are trying to change the mindset of the people from the community. And beside that, we have a lot of discriminatory legal policies at legal level. So we already have changed five or six discriminatory legal policies from our country court. And on top of that, we build the capacity of the young widows. Because in my country, more than 67% of the widows are in between 20 to 35 years of age, having three to four children in an average. And surprisingly, if you just look at this data, last data of the census, over 80% are totally uneducated. So you can imagine how much they have to depend on the male family members, where they get all kind of the physical and the sexual harassment.
Yeah. Are you hopeful about the future of widows in Nepal?
Of course, it's been 20 years that we keep, you know, we've been doing the advocacy and we keep advocate on the rights of the widows. I'm very much hopeful of that, and we've been able to change a lot of discriminatory legal policies from the country code in my country. But, you know, the widows issues is not only the issues of Nepal. It is a global issue.
Yeah. You feel strengthened by this conference?
Of course, because, you know, due to the conflict, due to the HIV/AIDS, and due to the natural disasters, and due to the poverty, you know, many young women have turned into the widowed. But surprisingly, you know, the widows' issues has not been incorporated in any of the international human rights and the declarations.
Thank you for addressing it here, and all the best with your work.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And I am very hopeful of this conference that everyone will keep advocate on the rights of the widows until there will be no discrimination on the basis of the marital status.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Lina Khalife from Jordan founded She Fighter, a school for self-defense and empowerment for women of all ages. The results of She Fighter are so promising that even the American President Obama mentioned them in his speech.
My name is Lina Khalife, I'm 29 years old from Amman, Jordan, and I'm the founder of She Fighter. So She Fighter is the first self-defense studio designed to empower women both physically and psychologically through self-defense training. Back in 2004, one of my friends, she used to work so hard after university to earn her living, but every time she goes home, her brother and her father used to beat her up and take her money. So I asked her once, why don't you do anything about all the abuse and harassment you get from your family? And she said, I can't do anything about it. So I thought about training women self-defense, and I started with only two girls, and I started in 2004 at the basement of my house. I started training Shifighter for girls at schools and universities, and now I manage to actually train girls at the rural areas and train trainers that actually can train in other schools. And the policy for Shifighter is women only, so the trainers have to be all females.
I am a Shifighter.
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 Soy una Shifighter.
I am a 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 Shifighter.
Moving on to more severe subjects, rape of women and girls as a weapon of war has always been there, but recently it has been more openly used, for example, in countries of former Yugoslavia and in Rwanda. The International Crime Court, presided over by Judge Joyce Alwoch, has made it a mission to end impunity.
Good afternoon, participants. I am Joyce Alwoch, the first vice president of the International Criminal Court here at The Hague. I want to start by congratulating the organizers of this conference, the third Global Conference on Women's Shelter 2015. I note the high participation at this conference, especially that one of the keynote speakers will be Queen Maxima of the Netherlands. Congratulations to the organizers. At the International Criminal Court, we deal with war crimes, crimes against humanity, genocide, and the definition of war crimes includes rape, sexual violence, forced prostitution, only to mention a few. These are crimes that are principally committed against women and therefore violate the rights of women. And I'm glad that this conference, you will address all these crimes and know that there is a permanent court that deals with the perpetrators of these crimes. Thank you.
Judge Alwoch. On Thursday, Dr. Denis Mukwege, also known as the man who mends women, will deliver a keynote on this subject. He's not only a doctor, but also a human rights activist, working specifically towards eradicating sexual violence as a weapon of war. I am that woman that you are talking about, a woman from the Netherlands. She was a teenager when she fell in love with the wrong guy.
Ik ben verliefd geraakt op een jongen en hij maakte nogal indruk op mij met zijn uiterlijk. En hij had voor mij een doosje bonbons meegenomen. En een doosje bonbons eigenlijk helemaal niet speciaal. Maar juist omdat ik uit zo'n slechte relatie kwam waarin ik nooit niks kreeg, was dat doosje bonbons voor mij wel heel erg speciaal. Want ik kende dat niet. Ik had dat nog nooit gehad. Eigenlijk de eerste 3 weken ging het heel goed. Wij kregen een relatie. En eigenlijk daarna werd het steeds erger. Als ik niet luisterde, dan sloeg hij me. Uiteindelijk ben ik dus gedwongen door hem om in de prostitutie te gaan werken en uiteindelijk ook om naar de Dominicaanse Republiek te gaan voor drugsmokkel. Ik ben daar opgepakt, veroordeeld. Ik heb daar 10 jaar gekregen in hoge beroep, dus daar verlaagd naar 5. Na 5 jaar ben ik teruggekomen naar Nederland. En vanuit daar ben ik eigenlijk aan mijn toekomst gaan werken. Heb ik op de bocht gewoond, mijn vrouwenopvang. En vanuit daar stap voor stap aan mezelf gaan werken. Ben ik mee voorlichtingen gaan geven. En toen ik daarmee ben begonnen, wilde ik heel graag uit iets negatiefs iets positiefs halen. Door met jongeren voorlichting te geven, maar ook in gesprek te gaan. Bewust maken en bespreekbaar maken over zowel over loverboys, maar ook over seksualiteit en grenzen. Met betrekking tot relaties, ongezonde en een gezonde relatie. Wat is nou het verschil daarin? En ik denk door mijn ervaring te delen met hun, bereik ik mijn doel, zeg maar. Ik schaam me eigenlijk niet voor dat wat ik heb meegemaakt. Ik ben wie ik ben en jij bent een slachtoffer. Maar ik wil ook niet graag gezien worden als alleen een slachtoffer. Ik heb meer te bieden dan alleen slachtoffer te zijn.
According to the UN statistics we showed earlier, only 10% of abused women ask the police for help. The Dutch National Police Corps has prioritized violence, which includes child abuse and sexual abuse. The Director of Operations of the Dutch Police Corps, Peje de Meij, is here.
Good evening. Violence against women and children is a serious safety problem in society. In the Netherlands, we count a yearly average of 45 casualties, 119,000 abused children, and more than 2,000 adults, mostly women, who face or fear violence. Our role as a police is to protect, to limit, and to confirm. We want to be a trustworthy partner in protecting women and children in need. We want to limit the abuse of women and children. And we want to confirm in every way that we can that domestic violence is unacceptable. Although safety is our core business, we receive a notification of domestic violence every 6 minutes. It is impossible to act solo on this. Since 2004, we therefore have chosen for an intensive cooperation with partner organizations, such as the Dutch Foundation of Women's Shelters. We share information. We developed a screening instrument and an alarm device, but sadly, absolute safety is not makeable. We still face fatal casualties every year, women who called in our help. Everything in us screams that especially these women and children deserve to live happily ever after. We will never find a solution to the problem, but knowing that is a raw deal. But we do have 65,000 police officers who want to protect anyone who faces violence, women, children, men, homosexuals, anyone. And we know in what direction we must head. The answer lies in connecting with partners, both national and international. It lies in combining our instruments, sharing our information, and be willing to learn. We, as police, want to learn from you. And we love to share with you in workshops that all we learned so far and what we stand for. Well-informed and connected to the bone, we can act together. We must, for the sake of safety and justice. Thank you for your attention. And I wish you an inspiring conference.
The Nigerian theater group Hear Word would have loved to be a part of the conference. But the good news is they will visit the Netherlands next year. In their work, they highlight all the positive and negative aspects of being a woman in Nigeria. They don't shun taboos, and they do succeed in affecting their audience.
Hear Word is a piece of performance art from Nigeria, which combines artistry, social commentary, and true life stories of inequality and transformation.
I say, he beat me. Then they say, What again? What is what again? Is that not enough? Our wife. A man must sometimes beat his wife to help her understand her place. She is awake, you see.
Enough is enough. Step up. Stand for, speak out, accept nothing less. It is time for change.
Violence against women can happen anytime, anywhere, and to any woman. Take, for example, Linor Abargil, Miss Israel and Miss World in 1998. 6 weeks before she became Miss World, she was brutally raped. She used her platform to get her story out in the open and to stimulate other women to do the same. And that is why she truly is brave Miss World.
I never wanted to be in pageants, but the price was a trip to Thailand and a new car.
I won the car before I had the license, so for me it was like heaven.
Miss World 1998, Miss Israel!
I was paralyzed. So I started screaming, so he punched my face. And then he tied my hand and started to strangle me.
Those were the longest hours of my life. I want to shout out that rape can happen to anyone.
I was raped when I was 17 years old.
A man broke into my house, stabbed me, and raped me.
My mom, I'm afraid that she'll look at me and be disappointed.
Shame and shock and fear.
She tried to convince me that it was my fault.
It's hard to go with all this weight on my shoulders.
I don't want to talk about what happened in Italy, or to think about it.
Someone gave me the courage to speak out when I was raped. It was my mother. She never let me feel ashamed.
Lino said, Ima, o vadalai, o nasoti, unisalil tsohoti. I can't forget this.
And there's nothing.
This work is bringing up a lot. I'm reopening my wounds.
So you will never admit to this crime?
No, ma'am. And I will go to fight.
I don't want to leave him in any way. I want to pay for what he did.
I'm here to see it through.
Can help only one girl or two girls. This just has to be done.
Linor Abargil.
Hi.
Hi. For more than 15 years now, you've been advocating the right of women to speak up about violence. Does your own experience still haunt you from time to time?
First of all, hi everyone. I'm very, very excited to be here. I feel that I have the privilege to be here and exchange ideas with people from all around the world and helping women overcome violence and adversity. What I've been through is with me, it's a part of who I am, but it's not who I am. I am a strong woman, I speak out, and I want everyone that sits here and around the world to do what I did, because women together is power.
Yes.
And we should stay together.
And can you, because you have heard during the past 15 years a lot of examples of women who were inspired by your example and also dared to speak up, can you say what can help people to overcome an experience like that?
First of all, I don't think any woman should be ashamed of what happened to her. To be raped is a violent thing. It's nothing sexual. It's a violent thing. It's about control. Somebody controlling your heart, your body, your soul. And I believe the only way to heal is to speak out. Speak out. No one speaks. No one. Nothing can change. Laws cannot change if no one speaks.
Do you see any progress over the past 15 years?
Wow. Step by step, small steps, but nothing major, nothing seriously. I wish. That's why the film that the conference represents, my film, Brave Miss World, now you're going to see it tomorrow with the Queen. So I'm very excited for that. The film is going all around the world in the hope of really making other women open up and not to feel ashamed, not to feel that like they are by themselves and that life moves on. And it's not how many times you fell down, it's how fast you get up.
Yeah. Thank you for your courage.
Thank you.
Financing and developing programs for children is often not a priority, while they are the next generation. The Dutch safe house Blijf Groep has developed Tony Turtle Time, creative drama therapy for the little ones. The Hague is the international capital of peace and justice. On October 25th, the Peace Palace in The Hague was colored orange to connect to and act with the UN campaign Unite to End Violence Against Women, a prelude to November 25th, the International Day of VAW.
Excellencies, friends, around the world, we are seeing a growing commitment to ending violence against women and girls. Eliminating violence against women is a key target in Goal 5 of our 2030 Agenda for Sustainable Development. And it was the top commitment noted by heads of state at our historic global leaders meeting last month at the UN. Here in The Hague, you will soon host the third World Conference on Women's Shelters. This is an important forum for advancing the issue of responding to violence against women and girls and ensuring that it remains a global priority. The Secretary General's Unite to End Violence Against Women campaign, which UN Women is proud to host, has declared the 25th of each month an orange day. The color orange is symbolic of a brighter future, free from violence against women for both women and girls. I commend the Netherlands for showing their support for this initiative by lighting the Peace Palace orange. You will be drawing vital attention to the importance of access to services for survivors, making sure all women and girls have access to quality essential services is vital, especially if we want to stop violence from reoccurring. This is a priority for women, and it must be a priority for all countries. I thank the Global Network of Women's Shelters, the Dutch Women's Shelters, the City of The Hague, and the Peace Palace for making this public demonstration of support possible. I cannot wait to see your results and to support your recommendation.
In the conference bag, you will find a book on the long history of women's shelters in the city of Rotterdam. The last 50 years, the focus has been mainly on violence against women, which makes this publication interesting for everybody working in the field. Emma Murphy came up with a way to use social media to help end violence against women. She's an Irish woman who suffered partner violence. Emma found the courage to publicly denounce the violence she faced using her mobile phone as a tool.
I've been thinking long and hard and contemplating whether to post this video. And I was and I wasn't and I was and I wasn't. I finally decided, after a lot of thinking, that, yeah, I need to do this for me and my children. I need to raise awareness to other women out there. I'm 26, I'm from Dublin, I have two children. I've been in a relationship for 3.5 years with a guy who I thought was the love of my life. He was the love of my life.
Violence against women, there's an app for that. Now time for a live column by Erica Olsen, staff member at the National Network to End Domestic Violence in the USA.
Hi, good evening. So our project at the Safety Net Project at the National Network to End Domestic Violence looks at how technology can be misused against survivors. It also looks at how survivors can strategically use technology to increase their safety and their privacy. And we can talk for days about what that looks like and all the technologies that we look at. But one example is our smartphones and the apps that are on there, because there truly is an app for everything. Apps have been developed to address domestic violence, intimate partner violence, sexual assault, and stalking. Developers have tapped into every conceivable need, including personal safety, awareness building, and violence prevention. There are screening apps to help people identify abuse. There are personal safety apps to help people to connect with family, friends, and authorities in case of emergency. And there's also documentation apps to help victims if they want to collect evidence. For survivors, their phones and these available apps can be a critical component to their safety planning. However, we need to ensure that they work effectively and that they're safe before survivors actually rely on them. On one hand, this is a brilliant use of technology. Apps can be tools to educate, empower, and strategize around safety and privacy. But they can also be ineffective, they can create a false sense of security, and they can reinforce victim-blaming messages around who is responsible for safety, messages that we're trying to work against. Survivors have to consider, before using these apps, if somebody could access or monitor their device, whether the app will work effectively, and any privacy implications. We also need to work to make sure that apps, as well as any other technologies, always consider survivors and their safety in their development. Thank you.
Can violence against women end without active support from men? The people at the Interval House Hamilton in Canada don't think so, and they will give a workshop on this subject. Here's one way that men can contribute.
Later, man.
See ya.
Hey, guys. You want to see something?
All right. Whoa.
Ooh, nice, right?
Man, is that your girlfriend?
Yeah.
Man, that's not cool. What, do you not have any respect for her?
None of your business, man.
Well, yeah, it's not really any of our business. Guys, we should delete this.
Not cool, bro.
You don't have to be a BC Lion to be more than a bystander.
The deputy mayor of the city of The Hague, Ingrid van Engelshoven, has addressed the participants of the Third World Conference of Women's Shelters.
Welcome to The Hague, the international city of peace and justice. The Hague is honored to welcome the Third World Conference on Women's Shelter here in the city. And I'm also glad to tell you that the Global Network on Women's Shelter find their permanent residence here in The Hague. And I'm looking forward to build a strong and powerful relationship with the network. During the conference in the coming days, you will connect to leading professionals in the field and build on partnerships, share experience. I wish you a very successful and inspiring conference, a conference that will help to stop violence against women and children.
So, rounding up this special edition of Women World News with the global weather conditions. Mexico, stormy weather due to rape, murder, and trafficking of women. Afghanistan, heavy clouds and rain, infiltration of women's shelter by Taliban, life-threatening situation for staff members. Jordan is sunny due to the success of She Fighter. The Democratic Republic of Congo, clouds and sunshine, because they have Dr. Mukwege, also known as the man who mends women. In the Netherlands, bright sunshine, so many people who work with women survivors and their children every day, now gathered in The Hague at this conference. Australia, heavy showers. In the first 5 weeks of 2015, 12 women were killed by their partners. And finally, the United States of America, sunny. President Obama keeps addressing elimination of violence against women and children as an important issue. And on that very bright note, we hope that at the end of this conference, you will feel inspired, energetic, and connected to old and new partners in a joint action to end all violence against women. For WWN, I am Aldith Hunkar. Good evening. She wow. could talk. I'm hot.
We're back. We are here again. And this very special edition of this very special journal can be seen on our website. And we encourage you to share it with friends and acquaintances all over the world during this conference. Before we go to the spectacular closing act of this opening session, we would like to welcome again our two chairs on the floor for a more formal closing statement.
Bandana and Femke.
They seem really surprised, so
yes, they do.
I'm curious what they're going to do with the situation. But they're well known to improvise, so
thank you.
Please.
Don't worry, we don't expect in half an hour from you.
So. That's a relief, really.
Yes. It's up to you, ladies. Any closing words for today? Uh-huh. Just to inspire the people for the rest of the week.
Yeah. Maybe a little word on the impression of this first session.
Yeah, first I think I will really have to thank you all for this very innovative presentation. You showed the world. Yeah. In a very short time, you showed us the status of the world, connected us, and I think generated power, as Miss Brave World said, you know, women together is power. So, and we need to speak out. I think those were the highlights, including the keynote speech. So I would like to thank the keynote speaker, you all the performers, and particularly the government of Netherlands for hosting this very historical conference. And for a very historical establishment of our Global Network of Women Shelters office here in Hague, the City of Justice and Peace. I think that has been the highlight. I would like to thank everyone, and we hope to see you tomorrow for a more exciting conference.
Thank you.
Very good.
Yes, there's not much left to say, I think, because you already thanked everybody. Let me just thank you.
Thank you.
For enabling us to make this conference. We are really proud to host the conference this year and to become the city where the permanent secretary will be. And thank you for this really good introduction of our conference.
Well, we've only
thank
just
you
begun.
So
we've
very much.
Yes, exactly. As
but it really inspires us. Okay. And thank you, Arjuns, for being here and for coming from all over the world. Thank
Wonderful.
You so very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Femke and Bandana. Thank you very much. I need a handheld microphone.
How you need a handheld. And I'm going to say a few, well, like practical things. Because, of course, we have the spectacular closing act later on. And afterwards, we invite you for a meet and greet until 6:30, 7, I think, more or less.
maybe a little later.
It's seven already. Yes.
Let's say 8:30, 9. There's a walking dinner, and it's an opportunity to meet everyone and greet and say and exchange pins maybe again. I don't know what you are going to do. We kindly request anyone with a headset, including everyone who has been on the podium, but on the stage, but also you who needed a translation maybe, to deposit the headset upon leaving this conference room. And then there are a few facilities for you here in the World Forum, and that includes a prayer room. There is a mobile charge point. There is, of course, first aid. There is a mother care room, and there is all the information available you need at the information desk and the reception desk. Then tomorrow, we start at 9 o'clock sharp with the plenary session, where Queen Maxima will give us a keynote speech, and we look forward to that very much, since it has been a very exciting few days that are now behind us, because she was ill. She's well
she's
again.
She's well again,
and
yes.
She's looking forward to being here tomorrow. The conference room will be open at 8:30, so you're welcome to take your seats from that time on. And joining Queen Maxima is Princess Mary from Denmark. I think for later on, a very nice evening and a wonderful dinner. And now.
Before I go to that, I have some breaking news, ladies and gentlemen. Oh. Yes, the our hashtag is trending in the Netherlands. Keep it going.
Oh,
yes,
good.
It
good,
is.
Good, good, good.
3WCWS. Keep using it in your tweets. And now, as Jacobine was saying, we have this fantastic ending to the first day of this World Conference of Women Shelters. And for that, I would like to call on stage now Monique Wilson. Monique, where are you? Monique.
Hi, I'm here.
There you are. Yes, we had her hidden away in the...
Hi.
Monique, you are going to do something with us all. Tell us about it.
Yes, first I'd like to explain who I am and why I'm here.
Yes.
I'm Monique Wilson. I am global director of the worldwide campaign called 1 Billion Rising. I think there's a lot of people who did risings here all around the world.
What is 1 billion?
Yes, a lot.
A lot of people.
1 Billion Rising is a global movement. It's a global call to action using art and activism, but mainly dance, to end violence against women and girls. It started 4 years ago, spearheaded by the playwright Eve Ensler, who wrote the acclaimed play, The Vagina Monologues, and who spearheaded the V-Day movement. After 18 years, she wondered, you know, why is our work still not ending? We were very naive. So she thought, you know what? We have to think of a very audacious, radical, wild, mad, artistic plan to gain back the attention of governments and the media and all the world institutions to really doing everything we can to end violence against women and girls. So all of us in the first year, 4 years ago, said, okay. She said, okay, we're going to get 1 billion people to rise. And why 1 billion? Because then the current statistic at that time of the United Nations was that 1 in every 3 women will be raped or beaten in her lifetime. So if you look at the math, like 1 billion women being raped or beaten every day was a staggering statistic. And it's almost like, how can we not be on the streets? How can we not be raging and doing everything we can in our power to do something about it? So we made a call, a global call. In 2013, 207 countries and thousands of groups rose around the world. It's continued since then. It was really inspired basically by Eve being in our amazing V-Day City of Joy in the Congo, headed by our V-Day Congo and City of Joy director, Christine Schulder de Shriver. And she saw the Congolese women through all their pain just dancing up a mountain. And she thought, wow, that is so inspiring. The energy that dance can bring, and also the collective solidarity we can all harness with each other. Wonderful. And I think this space really kind of shows it.
So are we going to do some of that now?
I think we can feel it coming.
I think so.
But I think we have to stand up again.
Who knows the dance? Who knows that one billion rising dance?
It's the Break the Chain dance. So basically what we're going to do is we're going to show a video. And I'm going to give my back to you, and we're going to follow the video in a mirrored way.
You are joining in.
I think all the OBR organizers from Taiwan, Germany, UK, Philippines.
There's many of you here.
You can go back, yes.
Please come and join me.
Who knows the dance?
Anyone who knows the dance.
Don't be shy, because we're all going to dance.
Don't be shy. And listen, I think we have, I believe, 900 delegates today from 115 countries.
Yes.
So I'd like to announce that we are actually breaking a world record for 1 billion rising today. We are all from 115 countries dancing all together in one space to end violence against women and girls.
But we will only break it if they join in.
Yes, so our theme this year is really revolution, because as we heard many of our speakers talk about it, we need to radically change consciousness and do everything in our power to end this epidemic. So, before we start, if you are by the aisle, is it possible for you to then try and dance in the aisle? And maybe some people can go in the front, because I understand it's very tight. And maybe you can spread out. And if you have the pink ribbons, you can put them in your wrist or in your forehead.
Oh, okay.
Or any way you want to tie it.
I need one. I'll get one. Soon come.
Here you go.
Ah, yes. Thank you.
So if my fellow OBR dancers can look at the screen. Sorry, we'll put our back
can
to you, but
me?
It's less confusing because it won't be opposite direction.
See, we're making friends already.
Our first attempt will just be a breaking into the dance.
Thank you.
So you don't have to panic. You just have to follow. And remember, the most important thing is to really connect with each other and have fun, because dancing for 1 billion rising is not just a defiance of patriarchy, but also a celebration of all your efforts that you've been doing all around the world.
So shake those hips.
Yes. So this dance is called Break the Chain, and as many of our speakers said tonight, the first thing we have to do is break the silence, but we cannot do it alone. We need to do it all together. So thank you everyone for being in this amazing space. We will do the dance twice. The first time, we will just get acquainted with some of the steps. You'll hear the young woman in the video speak out some of the steps, but some of the steps will entail some space. You don't have to go backward or forward because we don't have enough space. You can just improvise in your space. You'll hear words like box step, which is kind of like this. I promise you it's easy. This is the box step.
You can.
Why don't we try it first? Box step.
Box step.
It's just like
and
doing your legs in a box.
Legs.
Yes. Box step. Very good. Very good. And this is break the chain. Imagine you're breaking the chain on your thigh.
You should have told me. I wouldn't have worn this dress.
Break the chain. Break the chain. And then when you hear the young woman say party, that was her word, it's just like free dancing. Free dancing.
Okay.
Yeah?
Shake.
So in many ways, what we're doing also with the dance is breaking free of all the oppression that, you know, a woman's body has been really the cage of her oppression.
Yeah, okay.
So this dance is really breaking away from that.
Let's just do it.
Let's try it.
Let's do it.
Okay.
Just do it with conviction and energy.
Yes. Thank you, Monique.
You begin by improvising.
Sorry.
Slowly to the beginning of the song.
So you can do anything here. Maybe stretch.
On my knees.
You all right?
Good.
Fantastic.
I will walk through.
Okay, ready?
Party! Dance on, party! Pivot! Pivot!
the chain!
Down.
So will you just repeat?
Side. Side. Box. Box. Side. Side. Out. Cross. Cross. Up. Down. Side. Side. Stop. 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 Back. Forward.
And point.
Point.
Point. Point.
By now. Dinner.
Enjoy.
See you later. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Oh, gosh. I'm too old for this.